Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Tales from the Highway. That's right, Tales from the Highway. Guess what? You're seeing this on video, you're hearing it on Anchor, and you're seeing two beautiful ladies right over here. One of them is my ever so famous co-host.
Hi, guys.
The Queen of the Highway, Ferrari.
We also have this beautiful lady, if she gets in the shot, Sami.
No, she's not in the shot. Sorry, Sami.
And ladies and gentlemen, I will present to you, quite honestly, the princess of a royal family of professional wrestling. The Anoa'i Family. And I actually said it right on the first try, which makes me very happy. Ladies and gentlemen.
Vale Anoa'i.
You just said to introduce yourself, didn't you?
Yeah, of course.
I'm used to hosting. I hosted WXW Rage TV for years. It was always, good evening, WXW wrestling fans. I'm Vale Anoa'i. Welcome to Rage TV.
Well, we're on Rage TV, though, so you've got to go ahead and say it the right way now.
Good evening, everybody. Well, this is going to air. Good day, everybody. This is Vale Anoa'i coming to you live from Tales from the Highway, a wrestling podcast.
There we go.
That's beautiful.
Yeah, we're going to record that. Maybe we'll make that our intro from now on. Okay? So, ladies and gentlemen, we're coming to you. Unfortunately, while you're all watching the pay-per-view tonight, Hell in a Cell is on. We're recording this, and we're putting it out there in the middle of the week so you can enjoy it. So we didn't want you to miss it. So I hope you enjoyed Hell in a Cell. Next weekend, me and the Queen will go ahead and talk about what happened at Hell in a Cell. So you want to keep tabs on that while she's enjoying, you know, UFC.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, because the Outbreak MMA podcast will be attending UFC in Tampa.
Well, two of them anyway.
Yeah. Well. Yeah.
I won't be.
No.
I am going to travel back out to this fabulous area of Florida, Mineola.
Yay!
Where WXW is running at the Mineola
Mineola Recreation Center, 800 North U.S. Highway 27.
You almost think she was trained by somebody really well. I don't know. I'm just getting
it's almost like she grew up in the business or something.
Yeah, I know. I'm telling you.
No
like
way.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that.
Yeah, let's talk about
just
it.
Go ahead and get right into it. Let's talk about your life growing up in the wrestling business with your family, your wrestling royalty family, and everything that you have done.
Yeah, I don't even call it. Everybody calls it the Samoan dynasty. It's more like the Samoan royal family when it comes to professional wrestling.
Well, this is true. The there has been a Samoan in wrestling since the 1960s.
High Chief Peter Maivia.
Yes, the patriarch, and then his nephews, my dad and my uncle, the Wild Samoans. They kind of took the mantle when Peter was easing himself out, and then the Wild Samoans just took it and ran with it, and then their sons, their nephews, so many relatives have entered based on just Peter and the Wild Samoans. They opened a floodgate for Samoans to enter wrestling, and even I have nieces and nephews in wrestling. It's crazy. Cousins up the wazoo. I have so many cousins and all my brothers. It's pretty wild. Literally, as well as figuratively.
Well, I mean, Mark and I have said, you know, I mean, we tell anybody who will listen, like, not only would there be no wrestling without your family, like, because of how many are involved, but also how many have been trained by your dad or your uncle, you know, or Rikishi or, you know, your brother Sam or whoever, you know, whoever they've been involved with. I mean, they're responsible for so many people
including,
that have been in this
including
business.
Names like The Rock.
Well, yeah.
Like Dave Bautista. You know, so I mean that Dave Bautista.
And that's only two. I mean, yeah. How long can this podcast be?
I was going to say, you'll be here all day. Yeah. You start naming all the people that have come from a Samoan dynasty-led training center. It's insane.
Amazing.
Even Rusev. Rusev was trained by my cousin Reno, who was Rikishi's partner in his school. So they come from all areas.
Rusev. He had a great showing last past Monday Night on Raw a week ago on Monday Night Raw against Seth Rollins. So that was definitely glad to see him back. Of course, I care less about the whole entire
Lana thing. Yeah.
That just makes me sick.
Yeah. Well, we're not here to talk about that.
That's right. We're not here to talk about
Vale. So, Vale.
Yes.
When did you start working in the wrestling business?
I believe I was three. I was 3 years old when I started my first job, back when it was Trans World Wrestling Federation, TWWF. It was maybe 88, 89 when I started in the business. I would stuff the inserts into the programs the night before a show. And then I graduated to helping sell merch at the merchandise table. And then from there, I started selling raffle tickets. Then I started working the door. Then I started doing the music. I've done filming. I've set up the arena. I've taken down the arena. I even had to do a special guest ref spot one time. I've done ring announcing. The only thing I have not done is wrestle. I have done literally everything else a person can do except wrestle. And that's perfectly fine with me. I'll let everybody else do that. I'll do all the behind-the-scenes stuff and all of that, so.
Your brothers take care of all that, right?
Yes, brothers, cousins, uncles, students, even my fiancé. Like, wrestling is the center of my universe.
And it's funny because, you know, we talked, we were there earlier when we did your message in a bottle thing. That was fun, by the way.
That was totally a lot of fun.
If you actually live in the Orlando area, ladies and gentlemen.
Or even if you don't, it's not a bad drive on a Sunday, guys.
Yeah. Come out here to Claremont, to the Michaels, where you have a class.
Yes.
Message in a bottle. It was kind of Halloween themed this month. And you get to make your own little bottle with a little message you get to put in it. Of course, my message was probably never going to make it because I stuffed the bottle up. But nevertheless, it was a fun class. And you do so much more that it's not only just in the wrestling business, but outside the wrestling business. I mean, come on. You do.
Look at this house. This house is like an art gallery. And it's, you know, it's all paintings that you have done.
Yes, I have currently on my website, I want to say I have 614 works of art. And I'm an author. I've written 9 books. I do my little Bali's Very Treasure creations, mm-hmm. the painting. I dance, belly dance, ballroom, Latin dancing. I'm always creating somehow or another.
It's amazing watching your fiance, Julio. And for those on you who listen to us in the independent scene, you'll see him as the Cure of Vertigo. He goes around dancing, that ballroom dancing with you, and it's kind of so cute watching mm-hmm. you two do that. And I may get a little heat from that from Vertigo, but nevertheless.
No, he's a good guy.
Actually,
he's...
fun fact, he was a dancer before he even got into wrestling.
Oh, wow.
So he's got a long
He's got a story, too. We got to get him on the podcast.
You really
yeah,
do.
We'll do that sometime very soon, indeed. You not only grew up around your family in the business, but you traveled with your father into the realm of the then World Wrestling Federation. Mm-hmm. So you've gotten to see a lot of the characters that have come through, especially in the 90s.
The glory days.
Yeah, when your father, Afa, was at that time managing the team of Samu and Fatu, the head shrinkers. Mm-hmm. And of course, Captain Lou was with them as well for part of that. And I'm sure you have some stories about being on the road with WWF then. I would love to hear some of them.
Oh, I could be here all night.
Yeah, right?
I actually wrote and published a book called Growing Up Wrestling about that very subject. It goes, every chapter focuses on a different either wrestler or aspect of wrestling from the insider point of view. Because that all my life when I was growing up, people would ask me, what was it like growing up in a famous wrestling family? And then I'm like, why don't I just write a book?
Right. I think that's the only book of yours I haven't had a chance to read. I've read all the poetry books. The Sinwell Tyranny Asylum is like my favorite book that I still have to get back from Luke Harper's wife because I lent it and it's... Or I'm just going to buy another copy. It's that good.
Thank you. So let me see. Some stories from the 90s WWF scene. I remember one time... I was sitting backstage watching the show on the monitor, and it was Duke the Dumpster Drozzi was sitting with me, and we were betting on the match outcomes, like millions of dollars in little imaginary money, and he kept winning, and I hated it. I was so irritated because he always got it right, and I always got it wrong, He was so sweet. He was a really nice guy. Let me see. One time, Diesel stole my pizza. You want to talk about infuriated? You want to see a very angry human being? I am a Samoan Italian Taurus female. Rule one, don't steal my food. Rule two, don't ever do anything to my family because I am super protective and I will try to murder you. Mm-hmm. So that particular day,
yes.
Make sure.
That particular day, I was sitting on the stairs backstage and I put my pizza down, ran to go do something. I came back, my pizza's gone, and there goes Diesel walking away with my plate. I'm like, oh,
for shame.
I couldn't have been more than 9, but I was furious, and I still remember, you stole my pizza. And then that same night, I think, was when Macho Man Randy Savage knocked my dad off the edge of the ring. Now, I was little. I was young, but I was crazy. Samoan Italian Taurus female. Come on. So later on in the evening, I mean, I was like losing my voice screaming. I was so angry at him. So later on in the back, he comes over to me and says hello, and he was really nice, and I laid into him. Like, I tore him a new one, and he thought it was the funniest thing he'd ever seen, that this little tiny furious girl is just like laying into him because you knocked my dad off the ring. Another time, Bret Hart did something similar, knocked my dad off the ring, and later on in the evening, I was backstage, and I was talking to somebody, and he comes up and passes by, and I gave him an ice-cold stare, and I said, I don't like you. I like your brother Owen better than you. And then I just gave him a cold shoulder for the rest of the night.
Oh, I have to say, I love that one. Especially, that was right in the middle of a Bret Owen feud, too.
So. Yes. And then, back in the TWWF days, which was right around the same time, it was the very, very late 80s into the early 90s, we always used to use Kamala, the Ugandan giant. Mm-hmm. Now, I couldn't have been more than 5 or 6 at this point. I loved James. He was the nicest man in the world. But little tiny me sees him come out with that mask on, with that music playing. I would hide under the merchandise table and cover my ears and my eyes because he creeped me out so much when I was little. But I knew him and I loved him, but it's like that character, I don't know if it was the music or the mask or what, but yeah. I was just like, nope, I was under the merch table, hiding my eyes, blocking my ears. I was so little back then. And my first major, major, major crush was The Undertaker.
Oh, yes. My Undertaker has a way of freezing hearts. Oh, yes.
Yeah, he was the living end for me when I was a kid. And somewhere on my Facebook, I have a picture of me, I think I was 8, and we're backstage, and he put his hat on me and put his arm around me, and I have this face-eating grin, and like my eyes are lit up. It was just like, oh, I'm going to marry him. And then, funniest thing, a couple of years ago, somebody shared some wrestling gossip column thing on my Facebook saying that, you're not going to believe this, what was it, the 20 most shocking secret wrestling relationships?
Yes, it was like one of those like clickbait articles. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the number one piece in that article was apparently somebody saw a couple of pictures of me and The Undertaker throughout the years at WrestleManias. Somebody decided I was in a secret relationship with The Undertaker.
Yes,
I was some unknown woman.
I was in an affair with The Undertaker.
I was an unknown woman. And I'm like, you know, I would have really liked to have known that, considering I had a giant crush on him for so many years. I was in a secret relationship, but I didn't even know it. Like, it was the funniest thing, and everybody was messaging me, like, did you read it? I'm like, yeah, I read it, and I'm totally sad that I missed it. Like, was I in a coma, and I didn't know it? Like, what? It was hilarious. And then somebody else said the same thing about me and Batista. No, there was a picture of me and Batista, and somebody wrote an article and claimed that I was Batista's daughter. I'm like, listen, internet people, get your facts straight before you write articles, please. Pretty please. Thank you so much.
Fun stuff in the world of wrestling.
Right?
I'm trying to think of something else from the past. Oh, we used to live in Pensacola, and whenever WWE would come through town, a bunch of the guys would stay at our house. So we had Tito Santana stay with us a bunch of times. He would always go and buy a fajita the next morning. Like, his life was fajitas. I remember that.
So then we're Jesse Ventura with telling the truth all these years.
I guess.
Okay.
He loved fajitas. So Tiger Jackson, who was Dink the Clown, he used to stay with us all the time. A couple of the others, but Gangrel was always at our house. He and Luna Vachon were like my second set of parents. In fact, Gangrel used to be my babysitter. When Luna would get sick and tired of him and get mad at him about something, she would call my dad and say, "Papa, I'm sending a vampire to you for a couple of days or I'm going to kill him." So,
just like that too, by the way.
Exactly.
Just like that. I'm going to...
So she would just send Dave to us and he would stay with us for anywhere from a couple of days to a week or two. And it was great because he just loved being around us. He always did, and he still does. I adore Dave. He's one of my favorite people in the world. But one night, my parents went to Atlantic City, and he babysat me. We went down in the basement, we ate Chinese food, and we watched The Lost Boys.
Perfect.
I mean, is that like literally the most perfect day ever? So it was my first time seeing The Lost Boys and seeing it with a vampire named David.
Actual vampire.
While eating Chinese food, of all things. It's like, this is the dream right here. So yeah, the vampire babysitter is actually one of my stories in growing up wrestling. Another funny story. You know Gene Snitsky? Mm-hmm. He's like almost 7 feet tall. It was his fault, actually. Mm-hmm. And I have a story to go with that.
Okay.
He was, you know, almost 7 feet tall, huge, muscly, intimidating dude. There was a concert venue in Allentown, Pennsylvania called Crocodile Rock. That was my favorite place. All the good 80s bands would come there. I saw Sebastian Bach from Skid Row a couple of times. I saw Wasp twice, Jackal twice, a couple of really awesome 80s bands. I was supposed to see Janie Lane from Warrant, but he no-showed, and then he died, so that didn't happen. Gene Snitsky used to take... Bret Michaels, that was where this whole thing came from, because he was pretty close with the Bret Michaels band. So he took me to a Bret Michaels concert at Croc Rock, and we ended up getting home really late because I actually wanted to stay and see the show. And I had, back then, I was still in high school, I was young, it was a school night because, you know, the good bands never played on the weekends. So I got home after 1 o'clock in the morning, and Gene pulls up in front of the house, walks me. We had the sliding glass doors. We had converted the garage into a big editing studio / spare room den. And that was where Dad spent most of his time doing the editing and stuff. And Dad's sitting in there and he's looking out the glass doors. And Gene walks me through the door. He goes, "Okay, bye, Pops." Flies for his life back to the car and hightails it, burning rubber. And I'm like, "Et tu, Gene?" I mean, you're leaving me here to deal with the wrath of my father, and you're afraid. So Dad, of course, blows his top. "You're not going to go to another concert again." A week later, I was seeing Bret Michaels again in Hershey, Pennsylvania, courtesy of Gene Snitsky. But, Gene was terrified of my dad. Everybody was terrified of my dad. Every single one of our guys. Even Gangrel, to this day, he's like, "Oh, I don't want to get Pops mad." I'm like, "Dave, relax. Come on." But
it's funny you say that because, fear. Because I mean, most people know that, you know, we're friends with Luke Harper, and I mean, your dad had went in for a promo class at FCW.
Oh my god!
And Luke Harper was like, "I was so scared." Like Luke Harper, you know, like he's tall,
he's twice the size of,
you know. And he told me, and Mark, he's like, "I was like, it's Alpha, like, you know, like it's the Wild Samoan, you know." And it's like. Mark and I, like, well, we met Samu, before we met any of the rest of you. Like, we used to work NWL for, my brain is dead. House of Pain, you know? But, for John, and Samu was there all the time. Mm-hmm. And we got along so well with him.
Sam's the tame one in the family.
Yeah.
Like, he's the tame one. He's a good one to introduce you to the greater family.
Yeah, and he kept, like, "You guys need to work WXW," you know, and he was, like, pushing, and it took, like, I don't know, like, how many, 3-4 years before we actually got a spot on a show. And I will never forget the first time that we met your parents.
Mm-hmm.
We were like the first ones there. Like, they were just setting up the ring and everything, like from out of town, like of the wrestlers. And I will never forget walking up and, you know, kind of like, "It's so nice to meet you," you know, and like both Pops and Mom, Did you kids eat?
No.
Did you kids like eat? You know, they had food, you know, and we were like, oh, well, no, we figured we'd go to the Pizza Hut was across the street from the venue. Mm-hmm. And we were like,
well, Mountainville.
Yeah, we'll go eat at Pizza Hut. Oh, well, you know, you guys can, you kids can have this, you know, I'm Pops, you call me Pops. Like, and that's how it all started, you know, and I just remember Samu being like, finally, you guys are here, you know.
Oh, by the way, quick shout out to Samu. He's recovering wonderfully. He finally had that liver transplant.
So excited.
We're very excited about that, and he's recovering at home now.
Yes.
So that's some great news. And of course, we continued our thoughts and prayers to you, Sam, and we hope you get back to 100%. And hopefully 100% that puts you back in the ring, my brother.
Yeah.
You can't keep him out of it, that's for sure.
No, can't keep any of us out.
So. Nope. But yeah, it's a miracle. An absolute miracle that with stage 4 liver cancer, being on that transplant list for so long and so many close calls,
you know, I mean,
we kept thinking, you know, at this point it's like it'll either happen or it won't. Just when you're about to lose hope, boom, there it is. And it's like, wow. And then it all happens so fast. And now he's home. He's doing great. He's bored. He wants to get up and start doing stuff. It's like, you need to recover. You just got a liver. Slow down.
You have a brand new liver. Some. You know, I hear somebody else.
Some.
So we're going to take a quick break here, ladies and gentlemen. And when we come back, we have the worst tales coming. We'll be back.
Like me and most adults, you have daily aches and pains. One thing that has helped me with the discomfort is using CBD products. I'm not talking about medical marijuana. This has no THC and it won't get you high. There's been a lot of research about CBD helping with inflammation, and I can say from personal experience it does give me some relief. The company I recommend is CBDMD.com. They have all sorts of CBD products, oil tinctures and capsules, gummies, topicals, and bath bombs. They even have CBD oil for animals. Check them out at CBDMD.com.
Because singing is amazing.
Singing is amazing, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, it is.
James knows all about that.
He sure does.
The stylings of Vale.
Oh, we sang the entire time we were eating after my craft class.
80s music on.
A lot of 80s music on. Lots of 80s music. But you know what? I didn't have to listen to see what song it was because I had these wonderful ladies doing the job here.
I never do a job.
Right? Yeah.
Who is Shawn Michaels, 1997 era? Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah. I never do a job.
Gotcha. Gotcha. That's clever.
Oh, my goodness.
So, this Saturday, we're now, it's probably on Tuesday.
Yeah. It'll still be this Saturday.
It will still be this Saturday.
This Saturday,
WXW
is running again at the Mineola Recreation Center here in Mineola, just north of Claremont, folks, if you know where Claremont is. If you don't know where Claremont is, just go north on 27 from Orlando. You'll be fine.
Okay? You'll literally run right into it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, literally. I mean, there's a lot of hills. You know, you can't miss it, okay? So tell us what's going to be going on this Saturday.
Well, this Saturday is WXW's Fall Fever. It's one of two shows we have in October. The next one's our Halloween show, which I'm extremely excited about. But this one, we just got a new WXW champion, D. Ramos. And there's going to be a triple threat number one contenders match for his title. It's, let me see if I get this right. It's JD Amazing versus J Fortune versus Vertigo. And they're all big dudes. Mm-hmm. And they're all big dudes. So it's going to be a hard-hitting match. And they're all gunning for the chance to be the number one contender for D. Ramos. And then I believe there's going to be WXW Women's Champion Avery Taylor versus Raven Marie, who's flying in from Puerto Rico for this. Chico Adams, who calls himself The Future, called out my nephew, Lance Anoa'i, at the last show. Big mistake, Chico. Come on, dude.
It's The Future versus The Future.
Because Lance, The Future Anoa'i, and Lance answered that challenge. So this Saturday, Chico Adams versus Lance Anoa'i. For the first time ever, these two have never faced each other before.
I know, and you get to see it.
That is what caught my eye on why I had more to be out here.
I should correct myself from earlier. Samu and Lance are the ones in your family that we met because Samu used to bring Lance to every single show.
How old was he back then?
Like, God, I mean, we're talking 2004?
Oh, he was just a pup.
So, yeah, I'm like, you know, this tall with a basketball permanently attached to his hand, you know?
he and Sean Maluda were attached at the hip back then. Those two... Somewhere, now I know I'm going to get a lot of heck for this, and I really don't care. Somewhere in the archives, we have a VHS tape of what we called Front Yard Wrestling. It was in our house in Pennsylvania. We set up the video camera, and it was Afa Jr., Lance, and Sean Maluda basically beating the crap out of each other, having matches on the front lawn.
Yeah.
Hardcore matches with all kinds of props, like cardboard boxes and things, and chairs and cookie sheets, and... Lance couldn't have been more than 7 at the most. I think, yeah, because Maluda was, I don't even think he was 13. No, he was younger than that, because Afa Jr. was only 14, maybe, at the time. But the three of them were having these matches, and I was the ring announcer. And once I did a run-in, and then once my Rottweiler Brandy did a run-in, because she couldn't not, she sees them beating each other up, she's going to get involved. So somewhere in the house... that tape exists, and Maluda has, like, begged me numerous times, do not ever reveal that tape. If I find that tape, it's gotta hit the internet. That's gonna go so viral, so hard, but...
You could do, like, WXW roasts.
That would be fun.
Put it right on the screen inside the Mineola Rec Center when you, like, have the award ceremony. Yeah, I can see that happening.
That would be cool.
I can see that. I can also see Maluda losing his cool for that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he can't take a joke very well, that one. He's pretty serious.
And you know, you recently saw Sean Maluda on WWE on NXT.
Actually, funny story.
Yes.
We were watching NXT, but we were also discussing Rocksteady Wrestling, and without getting too far into it, Mark and Vince are constantly arguing. Constantly.
I believe
it. And they were, like, this close to screaming match. And all of a sudden I go, hey! Hey! And they're like, what? I go, Maluda's on TV. Shut your mouth.
Granted, it wasn't very long, but, you know.
No, but still, he was on TV.
Yeah, and Maluda was part of the Cruiserweight Classic.
Yes, yes.
So that was a big opportunity for him as well. And also during the Cruiserweight Classic, they had other alumni that have come through your school in WXW, including ERA. I know he's still getting better, so shout out to him. So that's somebody who came in here. My first show, actually, I actually was there invited by him at WXW. It was actually the very night that he regained the WXW Heavyweight Championship for his last reign. So that was really cool. And that's where I got to know WXW. So it was pretty cool. We have a new internet television champion in Rocksteady.
We do.
A product of the Wild Samoan Training Center.
Yes.
Nate Fury, right.
Yes.
Now, I want to say he was 14 or 15 years old when he first started training with us. His mother brought him to the wrestling school. He was a loner. Wrestling was his entire world. He loved wrestling more than anything, and she was willing to do whatever it took to help him live his dream. Mm-hmm. And he really, he trained well. He worked hard. He started out as a referee.
Yep.
The way we do things with the young, especially under 18 students mm-hmm. that have parents' permission to train, that's very important. We start them out as camera people. They learn every aspect of a pro wrestling business.
Should be.
Yes, because they really pay their dues with us, because they start, every current training center student has to be at every WXW show. They start by helping to set up the ring, and then most of them start out by becoming camera people. And then from camera, they graduate to referee. And then from referee, they graduate to wrestler. It's a nice little process, and it kind of gives him something to look forward to and work
to.
Yeah,
I think one of the first matches he was a referee for was either like a Highwayman match or a Mark Mandrake match, because that's what I told him the other night. I'm like, we've literally watched you grow up in this business mm-hmm. because of WXW, you know? And I do think that it was maybe not the first match, but maybe like one of the first few matches that he refereed was, you know, because he was like, you know, hi, you know, I'm your referee. And I remember he was real, you know, nervous, and you know, and now, I mean, just to see how far he's come over the years, and you know, he's just he works so hard, and he listens and mm-hmm. takes criticism well, and you know, it's just.
I'm going to tell you that on last Saturday night, when we had
that match, Rockstar,
him and Bobby Fonta stole the damn show.
Nice,
yeah. That was an amazing match. Back and forth, the crowd was hot.
Yeah.
I mean, when I say the crowd was good, sometimes, I mean, this one was hot. They were all for this match. A great pop at the end for him winning the title. Mm-hmm. So, you know, once again, congratulations to Nate Fury on a big win there. It was pretty amazing.
Well, I mean, speaking of champions, D. Ramos was on our show, too.
Nice.
I mean, you know, he's not a champion yet in Rocksteady, but I can see it happening, you know, because...
Another champion who is actually going to be on our next show on November 2nd is the reigning WXW Cruiserweight Champion. Excuse me for a moment. The Technical Alchemist, David Mercury.
Yes.
And you have to say it just like that.
I know, or he will let you know.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And remember, when it's all said and done, you know.
Right. Well, and, you know, unfortunately, Diamond Kid was subject to Mark Mandrake.
Mm.
Sorry.
Hey, it happens.
She is sorry. I want to let you know
I am sorry.
Mark is not sorry, and Mark is looking forward to doing it again, so.
I am sorry. Like, I got a little excited during the match, too. I might have... My hand slipped a couple times, and you know, but Mark went way overboard,
You were literally resting on the ropes. Unfortunately, his neck was there.
Yeah, I mean, he just, you know, he's very. Never mind.
It's wrestling. If they can't take it, they shouldn't be in the
ring. Mark.
Very lucky that I came out here and kind of stopped him from using that.
Mark went overboard. Mark went just a little. So.
I've seen him go crazy. It's quite spectacular.
Yeah, we had to stop it. So.
Mm. Yeah.
But, yeah.
Oh, and of course, our new general manager.
Oh, yeah. Surprise! We had a general manager that we didn't know who it was.
I got texts for months and months. I had no idea who it was, but yet that person was in our locker room practically the entire time.
Brittany Diamond.
Really?
Is our anonymous general, well, not anonymous anymore,
no,
general manager.
Very visual.
We were
now.
Definitely not expecting that.
Wow.
And so now
she's a big part of managing the women's division
boss.
In WXW. So
yeah, well,
she likes that power, doesn't she?
She really does. And, you know, Mark told her straight out he has a problem with authority, so we're going to see how that works out.
And she does not back down. That
woman
is tough.
No.
She will get right up in your face and just...
Mm-hmm.
So one of my favorite events that's going to be coming up in WXW is coming up in November.
The Samoan Cup.
Yes.
The Wild Samoan Tag Team Tournament. That event actually started in Pennsylvania in 2004, I think it was. And then many years later, we brought it back to Florida, and then we've been doing it annually ever since. Because the Wild Samoans were tag team specialists, tag teams were their whole thing. And there were so many tag teams in our family, the Wild Samoans, the Head Shrinkers, the Samoan SWAT team.
Most recently in wrestling,
the Usos.
Yes.
3 Minute Warning, I could go on. The Samoan Gangsters in ECW. There were so many tag teams in our family.
3 minutes and we're out of here.
That we decided to do a special event honoring tag teams, because tag teams don't often get the attention they deserve. Everything goes to the singles wrestlers. So we wanted to do a special event just for tag teams. And the first one, tag teams came from all over the country. And every year we try to bring in some different teams, but then a lot of the same teams, because some guys have been trying to win it every year, and they get so close. And it's a tournament. There's usually, I believe, 8 matches. It's tournament style, you know, the qualifying matches, the semifinals, and the finals. And the winning team gets a really nice set of trophies and a special plaque, a little trophy piece that goes on the big trophy in the office of the Wild Samoan Training Center.
Yeah, you guys go all out with that, because Mark has medals, you know. I mean, like, and they're not participation medals, guys. They're honorary medals, like, thank you for being a part of WXW. They're really beautiful. And, you know, it was being part of the Highwaymen, you know, in a couple of the tag team tournaments for the Samoan Cup. But, I mean, they're beautiful.
And the nice thing, too, is the winners get big trophies, but even the runner-up team, they get trophies, too.
Right.
Because they made it so far in that
tournament.
Made
it to the finals.
Yes. And it's hard. It is hard having to wrestle multiple times in one night.
Yeah. And, I mean, you bring in high-caliber talent. You know, I mean, you've got your own homegrown talent. Plus, you bring in, I mean, because I remember, I think the last time the Highwaymen were, they wrestled Samu and Lance, actually.
Yes.
The great thing about the tournament is sometimes it's not even established tag teams that are involved or win.
Mm-hmm. Guys that are just kind of, they want to band together just to have an opportunity. And it's like, well, how does this work? Like, you
sometimes it's even people who don't even really like each other, but they want that distinction.
It's funny you mention that, because I noticed a team that has started bonding a little bit, and that is your reigning WXW champion, D. Ramos, and the Diamond Kid. They've been kind of palling lately, and they very well may be the next team that actually will enter that tournament and possibly even come out the winner.
They're both talented.
Because I know Diamond Kid and Vinnie Mac are the new breed.
Yep.
But you never know what the future holds. You know, feuds happen, fights happen, misunderstandings happen, weird alliances happen, especially when it comes to the Samoan Cup, because the stakes are high, the reward is big. It's a very prestigious event. We wanted it to feel prestigious. Mm-hmm. Not just another wrestling show, but a special something different.
Right, and actually that same year that the Highwaymen wrestled Samu and Lance, PWI came and covered it. Dan Murphy from PWI came and covered it. So, I mean, it gets national, international recognition. So,
and we try to coincide it as close to my dad's birthday as possible.
Yeah.
His birthday is November 21st.
We have a lot of stories about that we can't tell.
Scorpios. I love you.
Uh-oh.
But, yeah,
that was the same night that your dad was not allowed to leave the office, and I was left to keep him in the office, and he threatened me with a roll of duct tape.
I've heard this story. I think I've heard this story.
Oh my gosh.
You're lucky that Mark came in after that.
Yes, yeah. Mark saved me.
Yeah, I've heard that. I've heard that story, folks. Maybe someday we'll have a Tales of the Highway on that one.
Fun fact, too, but Ricky Santana and my dad have the same birthday.
Yes.
So 1 year.
That week is.
Oh, it's wild. It's party time.
Me, Audie, your dad, Ricky, when Jamie D was around, you know, I mean, it was like one day after another. We just like.
I have a cousin.
Vince's birthday is the day after mine. So it was like a whole week of birthdays.
So, ladies and gentlemen, on the week of the 21st of November, you'll make sure you stay off the roads, especially if you live out in this area. So, So that's one of my favorite courses. I was fortunate this year to actually see the Extreme Rumble.
Oh, the Extreme War.
The Extreme War.
That's always fun.
Yeah. That was a fun show.
Around Mark's birthday.
Yeah, that's April. In April.
Yeah.
So that's definitely a cool event. It's almost very similar to the Royal Rumble. It's different though.
The rules change a couple of times in the middle of the match. It keeps you on your toes.
So that was definitely a fun thing. I know recently you had a cruiserweight tournament, which was won by the technical alchemist, David Mercury, who then took two tries, but then procured. I'm saying all the big words for you, David. Come on, give me a shout out later on. Procured the cruiserweight championship. So
another thing about that, something that Vertigo noticed, and I was like, wow, that's actually freaking genius. He never touches the belt because Mercury and Gold can't touch. He always either has the gloves or that thing that holds it for him. He never touches the belt. And I'm like, holy crap. That is taking it seriously. That's amazing. I love that. Just a fun little fact.
We should make a nickel belt.
Ah.
Because then he can touch that.
Maybe.
Let's see. I don't know. That's a great suggestion, don't you think? Leave your comments. Let us know, okay? So, yes, ladies and gentlemen, it would be October. I don't know what date it is. What date is it right now? It is October the 6th.
Today we're recording on the 6th.
So it'll be October,
which is Afa Junior's birthday. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Afa Junior. In case, I know some folks might not know this, so Afa Jr., you will know him as Manu when he was in WWE.
Or the Samoan Storm way before then.
Yes.
Nevertheless, happy birthday to you, sir. And, so wait a minute, yesterday was the 5th, 7th, 8th, 4th, 4th, 12th, 12th.
October 12th is WXW, and then 2 weeks later is your Halloween show.
Hold on.
Yes.
She has a wonderful voice. She loves promoting things. The floor is yours.
Well, thank you, sir. This Saturday, October 12th, WXW returns to the Mineola Recreation Center for Fall Fever. You do not want to miss this one. Doors open at 6 o'clock, bell time 6:30. Tickets are available at WXWWrestling.com, or you could buy them at the door the day of the event. We hope to see you there.
Beautiful.
Thank you. Hosting voice. I was born missing the shyness gene. From the time I was an infant, pretty much, I was just... It was impossible for me to feel shy about anything.
You're a born artist and performer. I mean, you just...
And not just on my dad's side. You know, everybody only knows the wrestling aspect of everything. But believe it or not, my mother's father, my grandfather on my mom's side, he was a professional country and western singer and guitarist.
Right.
So I get entertained from both sides.
Not only do you have the loud Italian genes, you also have performance genes, you know?
Yeah, it's funny. She does a pretty good job. Did you hear my introduction for Rocksteady last night? We'll have to show you that later on.
Yeah, last night I was actually at an 80s arcade playing all the old games. It was the coolest
thing. Did you
find,
WrestleFest in there?
No, he didn't have WrestleFest.
Oh, shame on that.
I know. I was playing Golden Axe. I was playing Alex Kidd. Like, I'm talking old school. Really fun stuff.
I always used to play as the Earthquake.
Oh, in WrestleFest.
Yes. I was always a huge John Tenta fan.
They even have an arcade Tetris that glitches out like it used to in the 80s. I was screaming at it. I'm like, I will beat this machine to a bloody pulp. If machines could bleed, which they can't. But anyway.
It can leak fluid, can't they?
Yeah.
True.
Well, maybe the same thing as blood in this case. No problem. And buckets have been... buckets. Gallons have been spilled in your family. So
that is true.
Certainly true on that side. And
I still, to this day, say one of the most visually shocking moments was when Captain Lou slammed my dad over the head with a wooden chair.
Oh, yeah.
Back at that. And then... The way he fell, it looked like he broke his neck. That chair was still around his neck when he fell. And then walking backstage with the chair still around his neck, blood pouring down his face, that to me has stayed in my head since earliest childhood.
Yeah, those wooden chairs are
they're heavy and they are solid.
Yeah.
Crazy.
My only visual that I remember of a wooden chair being used was when when Larry Zbysko used it on Bruno Sammartino, and that ripped his head apart.
Yeah, those chairs are no joke.
Yeah, yeah, that's an amazing thing right there. So, yes, ladies and gentlemen, don't forget to get your tickets for WXW this Saturday. Many of all the recreation centers, we said bell time is at 6:30. You get there by the doors open at 6. They do have plenty of merch there. They have a wonderful snack team. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, the last time I was there, I remember this guy named, what was his name? Sugar. Yes, that's right. He was selling hot dogs. I remember that.
He was being getting punished. Pretty good at that. He was being punished because he was a very bad boy. But he has since turned his life around and turned over a new leaf for about the 80th time.
We'll see how long that lasts.
Yeah, he flip-flops all of that.
So he's somewhere in a big show land right there.
Yeah.
Good, bad,
bad.
Good, bad.
For years. Ever since he's one of the original WXW mainstays from the early days in Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
He actually moved with us.
Yeah, he was there when we were working for you in Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, he moved down with you. There was like a crew that moved down.
Yeah.
Funny story, I want to say it was the early 90s when he joined the training center, and he walks in, he's bald, he's black. We already had a Jason, his name's Jason Simpson. So mm-hmm. Our office manager, Katra, who was also a wrestler for years, she called him OJ, and the name has stuck all these years. Mm-hmm. To us, he's OJ. He's only ever been OJ. So when I hear someone saying Jason, I'm like, who? Right. Oh, OJ. But that name has stuck by him for all these years. And so many stories of the training center. I remember it was, again, the early 90s. The Undertaker and Paul Bearer showed up at our school one day at the wrestling school. And, of course, little me was goo-goo-eyed over the Undertaker. And you would think I couldn't have been more than 6-7 years old. And I was nagging Paul Bearer. I wanted to see what was in the urn. He kept trying to scare me and kind of push me away from wanting to know what was in it. I would not let up. It's like, I wanted a tattoo from the time I was 5. Mm-hmm. Like, I was that kid. Well, come on. I was raised by a wild Samoan, and Luna Vachon was my other mother.
Mm-hmm.
Hello? I'm not going to turn out exactly normal, everyday anything.
What is normal?
Who cares? A setting on the washing machine.
Yes,
that's what.
It is.
Thank you, Harley Quinn, for that quote.
Nice. All right, ladies and gentlemen, make sure you show up there on the 12th. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to go ahead and close out everything. I hope you're enjoying this. We'll be back in just a few moments.
Like me, and most adults, you have daily aches and pains. One thing that has helped me with the discomfort is using CBD products. I'm not talking about medical marijuana. This has no THC and it won't get you high. There's been a lot of research about CBD helping with inflammation, and I can say from personal experience it does give me some relief. The company I recommend is CBDMD.com. They have all sorts of CBD products, oil tinctures and capsules, gummies, topicals, and bath bombs. They even have CBD oil for animals. Check them out at CBDMD.com.
Gentlemen, real quick here, we're back here. We're going to go ahead. We want to say hi to Mom.
Hi, Mom.
Joining us here.
she's gonna let the very loud dog in, so bear with us.
Yeah, she'll pop back in, I'm sure, ladies and gentlemen. So, real quick here, I don't mean to take any of your time away, but we have some business we have to cover.
Go for it.
Mind.
By all means.
So, last Saturday, we had Rocksteady.
Hey.
Hi, Sammy.
And she has tales to tell, too.
Yeah, she has tales to tell. And a lot of things happened that night. First of all, congratulations again to the son of a warrior, Nate Fury, on being the inaugural RSW Internet Television Champion. And he is right away having a huge title defense coming up on November 2nd. A rematch with the Who's Better Than Bobby Pompous.
Yeah, who's better than Bobby?
Well, apparently that night it was Nate Fury.
Right.
But we'll see what happens, because the match now will be a ladder match.
Ooh,
the winner of that match is going to climb the ladder and attempt to capture the championship, and that's going to happen on November 2nd. Also signed by our new general manager, and that will be, we're going to say, recognized general manager, Brittany Diamond, a triple threat match. I'm scared for Diamond Kid, really.
Yeah,
not so much
he's
scared.
In a bad situation.
Not so much scared
because
for Ati or Mark.
I mean, I don't want to go into pieces.
Ooh, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Mark, Ati,
right,
and the Diamond Kid.
Right, and I don't want to get too far into it because I don't know if you listened to that edition of the podcast, but Ati is not the Ati that I remember. He went off on everybody.
Everybody.
Really?
Family.
Excuse me?
Yeah. And Mark lost it.
Huh.
A lot of Mark's mental state right now is because of Ati, who literally took over the podcast. I got screamed at by Mark for that happening.
I may have thrown a water bottle at him. I don't really remember. And I left.
You did.
In a huff.
You did.
Really loud huff.
Nevertheless,
Mark plans on taking care of the situation November 2nd.
Mm-hmm.
So
Mark was on the podcast last week. This past Saturday beforehand, and my goodness, right in my face about that whole entire thing. And very simply put, he wants out, and he's gonna get it.
Yeah.
He's gonna get. You know what? Either way, whether Brittany was there or not, it was gonna happen. Because guess what? I was going to get it done. I was working on it. So, the Diamond Kid, as Mark said on the post show, is casualty of war, and very good. But you know, here's the thing: cage match.
Rules of
a cage match are very simple. First person to score a victory in the cage is by either pinball submission or escape the cage. If the two of those monsters are facing each other, Diamond Kid could very well climb out.
That's true. Yeah.
So they need to very well keep an eye on it. So that is a big thing coming up here. And that's coming up on November 2nd, Goldview Events Center. Our doors will open also at 6, but we're going to start at 7. So that way you have plenty of time to get out there, because we know you want to go out and meet your favorite superstars and get an opportunity to see what's going to happen that night. It's going to be very interesting. Of course, if you see their flyer now, which should be out by now for your visual information. It is representative of the Day of the Dead, which also happens on that side.
Right, that week.
How do you say it in Spanish?
El Día de los Muertos.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yes. Yeah, we decided to honor, you know, the tradition of Day of the Dead. You'll see when you get to the show, there will be things honoring Día de los Muertos.
Oh, that's nice.
And that's going to be our traditional, you know, annual show.
Nice.
Anybody who knows Mark, especially, and me, we love the Mexican culture, so we really wanted to honor that.
You've been to Mexico several times.
Yes. Yeah, and planning at some point to escape to Mexico.
Don't
retire
blame you on
that to Mexico.
That'd be nice.
Don't blame
you
on that one.
Yeah.
I still really want to go there. I want to see the Pyramid of the Sun. I want to go visit the ruins and explore the jungles. I totally should.
You should.
I really should.
We're just gonna take
I told them once they make it, send me off for vacation.
I think you and Vertigo and me and Mandrake on a couple's cruise.
That would be amazing.
And, you know, and we can show you all the cool pyramids.
I'm single. I need a good person to go with this. I would like to do this. Okay?
What is this? The match game? This is a slay. Find a girlfriend on your own time.
hey, what better place than a podcast?
No, really, James is a great guy. If anybody, you know.
I'm going to be a very much thinner guy very soon, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, looks, hey, it's all about personality.
Well, I really have a personality.
You have a great personality.
What are you all talking about?
And he's a wonderful family man, and he has custody of his niece, who is a very, very intelligent, very sweet, smart, great kid. And that's to you and your mom, you know. But, hey, Bali's here. Sorry. You tried to pull things about you again.
I like this, though. It's sweet. Right? I think it's sweet.
Well, you know. But
wrestling has actually been surprisingly good at being a matchmaking.
Yeah, well, that's how Mark and I met.
Industry.
And that's how you and Vertigo met. And
yes.
You know.
So that was all these years. Is all I need to do is get into wrestling here.
See,
and
yet now you're in the right place. So now we just have to find the right woman for
it. It's funny that you mentioned the fact that, you know, you're in the business and everything, because when I was growing up, I loved watching. But I paid attention to some of the little things. Like, I was always a big thing about the production.
Mm-hmm.
But my favorite thing is ring announcing. And that is one of my passions. And I will eventually do it one day. I will say I had the best opportunity I ever had is I did get to visit the Performance Center in the WWE Performance Center.
Mm-hmm.
About 3 years ago. I did a little the All Access that they had there. That was probably one of the coolest nights I ever had.
It's a beautiful facility.
Oh, yes, it is. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you something right now. Yes, it cost a pretty penny. But if you have an opportunity to actually go out there and see the WWE Performance Center, go out there and see it. It is an amazing facility, state of the art. I got to sit there and call a match actually with Corey Graves because he was still in the Performance Center at that time doing NXT, which was really cool. Did my old promo with the Ely Twins, which was really amazing because at that time I was getting in the face of the Largo show with the Authors of Pain. Yes, I actually stood up to the Authors of Pain. I might be nuts for doing that, but nevertheless, I did it. It was really fun. And then that night they do a show that you get to be part of it. And it was my birthday also.
Perfect.
So they actually had me do the ring announcing twice. Well, I'll tell you what I did for the first match, which, by the way, had Noah. As well as Patrick Clark, who is now the Velveteen Dream.
Nice.
So that was really cool. To do that, and I got to do that, and I didn't do it in just any other voice. I did it in the best voice in the world, Howard Finkel.
That was a very good imitation. I adore Howard Finkel. He is one of the coolest, nicest people. His nickname from my dad is Coffee. For years, he has called Howard Coffee. Funny story that goes with that, but maybe we'll save that for next time.
Next time, I'm sure, and we would definitely have you back on the show. Oh, I guarantee you that.
There are so many stories.
I got a lifetime.
But you know what? Here's a wonderful thing here. You're not just dealing with WXW in the wrestling business. You have a lot of ventures. Yes, Ferrari's kind of hinting to one of them. You have a lot of ventures that you do outside of wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like you to go ahead and touch on those. Go ahead and leave us some information on some of the things you do that people can participate in.
Right.
And all around, you know, let everybody know what this princess of the Samoan family does.
Well, one thing I will say is that a lot of wrestling children, whether they're in the business or not, some of them have kind of a chip on their shoulder. And they're bitter because their parents weren't around. But I was extremely fortunate that my dad, whenever he could, he brought me and my mom on the road. We got to travel to Austria. We got to go to Italy for wrestling tours. And that was so important. We always felt like we were part of it. Mm-hmm. We never felt like we were just the baggage at home. We were very much involved, especially with dad running the training center and WXW and Trans World before that. But I digress. As far as things that I do outside of wrestling, the reason I brought that up is because with some people, wrestling is all they have. That was my dad. My dad, wrestling became his entire world, and that was all he had. Same with my brothers, same with my cousins. Most of them, wrestling is all they have. I am actually pursuing my bachelor's degree in, of all things, religion and cultural studies, because I've always been mega fascinated with world cultures and spirituality and different aspects of the human mind and what people believe and what drives them, what motivates them. So it's kind of like a combination of psychoanalysis and belief, and it's a really, really cool major. My ultimate goal is to be a special education teacher, and I've been working at a school for students with special needs since 2012. I adore my job. I have so much fun at work, even if I'm getting beat up and other such things. I love my job. It's, I guess, being a wrestler's daughter, it's kind of fitting that I should be in a very physical, active job, but I love my kids. They're all my kids. Every kid in that school is my kids. So aside from college and my day job, I'm an artist. This is just one of my 614 works of art. I do mostly acrylic, some watercolor. I do art shows pretty regularly. There's a gallery in Longwood called Kaleidoscope Venue for the Arts that has a whole bunch of my originals, but not too long ago, a couple weeks ago, I did an art show at the Wild Samoan Training Center. Mm-hmm. Yes. And it was the first time there'd ever been an art show at the training center. And I'm like, well, we have the building. I may as well utilize it, bring my two worlds together. And it was actually super successful. I ended up selling 13 paintings that night.
Well, that art show you did at the rec center, first time, Vince and I came out, and we had other artists there too. I know Vertigo had some of his stuff out.
And that was before we were even together.
Right? Mm-hmm. But it was such a good time, and that was successful too. Didn't you sold
I sold 34 paintings.
Right. I know I bought one of yours. I bought something from somebody else. It was a They Live thing about Roddy Piper. I have it at home.
Oh.
Yeah. And I was like, I can't leave this here. This has to be, you know.
That was either the Coriels or...
It
might have been... I don't know, but I
don't know. But that was a lot of fun.
If I remember correctly, just this past, 2 weeks ago, you were doing at WXW, you had some of your paintings there, and quite a few people right off the bat, before the doors even open, were already buying your paintings.
Right.
I always have a table set up by the door that has a bunch of my smaller paintings, and these are like $10 and $20. It's not like they're prohibitive. I always like to have my art table at all the wrestling shows, because... Mm-hmm. Somebody always buys.
Right. It's, you have the paintings, nice, you have some of the buried treasures. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you have copies of the books too, because that's where I got most of your books. Mm-hmm. Is I would buy them at the shows, and like, you know, every time I'd be like, I'm going to get this one.
And then aside from my art, I'm also a dancer. Like I mentioned earlier, I've been doing belly dance for over 10 years. And aside from belly dance, back in April, we started doing ballroom and Latin dance. We do all kinds of dances. My personal favorite's the Argentine tango. I adore it. We do American tango, Argentine tango, rumba, waltz, salsa. Swing. Swing's really fun.
Yeah.
Mm. It's a blast. We did some cha-cha. We did some hustle. It's so fun. It's great exercise. It makes you feel good. And we're basically doing it so that when we do get married, we will be able to tear up that dance floor and impress everybody in the building.
What day are you getting married?
We are getting married on Halloween of 2021.
And who was there when you picked out your beautiful wedding dress?
You were. Ferrari was there when I went to go pick out my wedding dress.
And it's amazing.
It's a really cool dress.
And I was actually telling James on the way here, I was like, you know, it was really great because Mom and I just like let you like just try it. You tried this on. We were like, oh, that's pretty. You're beautiful anyways, you know, so any dress is going to look great. And you came out with that dress, and it's like, you know, if anybody's been in a situation like that, you just were like, the look on your face was just this like of like amazement and, you know, just like relief and peace and excitement. It was like all of these emotions, and you could just see it.
And it was the first one I tried on. Mm-hmm. I knew the minute I put it on, I'm like, it's this one.
Yeah.
I tried the other one. We tried the formality.
Like six more, and it was like, oh, this one's nice too, but this one.
Speaking of your mom, you and your mom both had a challenge that you have done within the last few years.
Oh, yes.
And I think it's very important to say, because you mentioned, I mean, not first of all, I mean, you've always been a beautiful woman, okay? But
good genes.
Yes. But there was a time where you were not as small as you are.
Oh yeah.
And quite honestly, if anybody knows the Samoan family, it almost runs in their genes that they are going to be a large stature.
Okay? And being Samoan and Italian, I was kind of cursed from birth. It's like there's no way I'm going to be
surrounded
small.
By food. Right. Yes. You know,
so
but your mom has done an amazing job of being able to coach people, and the two mm-hmm. of you kind of teamed together, mm-hmm. and you have both lost significant
weight. Well, because you did it first, right?
Well, actually, how it all happened, I was 100 and in May of 2014, I was 189 pounds, and I'm 5'2" for God's sake, mm-hmm. 5'2", and that. Trip. We happened to be in Pennsylvania visiting Samu for his 50th birthday. Mm-hmm. And it was the day we were getting ready to leave, and I was sitting in my brother Lloyd's house drinking a Diet Coke. So I was always drinking Diet Coke. And I just was reading the can, and I'm like, you know, I'm never going to drink this again. And I just put it down, and I never touched it again. In 1 week, I lost 8 pounds just from quitting the soda.
Isn't that amazing? Like, you just cut out something that, like, you don't think about how much of it you're putting into your body. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So then, in September. It was September 1st of that same year. I was 181 pounds, and I was hosting Rage TV. And I'll never forget, I was wearing a purple shirt that I loved, and I thought I looked really good in. At the time, my hair was down to my butt. I always had super long hair, and I had this shirt on, and I'm hosting the show, and we were using the new wide-lens, high-definition cameras. And then I saw myself on screen, and that was the smack in the face I needed. I looked at myself, and I'm like, I'm that big? It's like I didn't see it. I had blinders on for years. I was belly dancing at 100 and almost 190 pounds, and I thought I looked great. I had all the body confidence in the world. But that wide-lens HD camera, it kind of knocked me for a loop, and I was miserable. I'm like, I cannot believe it. How did I let myself go? How am I this big? So I started. I'm like, I am never going to be this big again. So mom's like, all right, let's do something about it. Mm-hmm. So the very next day, September 2nd, we decided we're going to change everything about everything. We started eating 1,000 calories a day. Mm-hmm. That was it, just 1,000 calories a day. And it took about 9 months, but we both lost 70 pounds and more than 70 pounds, just from restructuring the way we ate. Mm-hmm. 1,000 calories a day. It could be whatever you wanted, as long as it was 1,000 calories. We didn't even start exercising until, let me think, September, October, 6 months in. Mm-hmm. Then the weight just started pouring off. And then I got so thin, like it was kind of terrifying. I actually got down to 118 pounds. Mm-hmm. I was a skeleton. It looked really, really bad. And that was when I'm like, okay, I'm becoming a little too obsessed with losing weight. So then it's like, we gotta dial this back just a little bit. So then I was coasting around the high 120s for a really long time. But regardless, I was healthy and I felt amazing. I had super bad plantar fasciitis when I was at my heaviest, to the point where the doctors wanted to have surgery on my feet. I'm like, no, no, you won't. Losing the weight, my feet have never had a problem since.
Right.
I had high blood pressure, losing the weight fixed that completely. Mm-hmm. All kinds of other stuff was going on health-wise, and I'm way too young to have those kind of health problems. Mm-hmm. Losing the weight changed everything. Everything. Mm-hmm. I was getting migraines all the time, all kinds of really bad stuff. The weird thing about losing the weight, though, was a couple of months in, I started noticing, like, weird changes in my body. I guess losing all that weight kind of reshifted things somehow, and I ended up developing a sudden-onset gluten intolerance. So I had to completely, again, restructure the way I ate, because everything I ate had gluten in it. So I had to cut that completely out of my diet.
Well, because you're a vegetarian.
Yes, I'm a vegetarian on top of it. So as you can imagine, eating out is a process. I have to research the menu. It's a pain in the butt, but enough about that. Regardless, my mom and I lost over 70 pounds, and she's still constantly in the gym. And we walk a lot. We do hour-long walks. We do 5-mile hill walks. Like, we're always, as often as we can, we walk. And that really helps to keep the weight down. Just the cardio from walking, because we have a lot of hills in our neighborhood. So you're not just getting a flat walk. You're getting a full workout doing those hills. They're steep. and it has really helped. And I mean, my weight, you know, it kind of fluctuates here and there, but it stayed relatively close to my goal, which mm-hmm. is important. And so, yeah, mom especially has really pushed her I lost to gain business. And it's so much more than just weight loss. I lost to gain is very much a whole lifestyle. It's physical, mm-hmm. it's mental, it's emotional. And together we actually co-wrote a song that I sang.
Yes.
And the whole chorus is, I lost shame to gain my confidence. I lost anger to gain my joy and light. I lost apathy to gain motivation. I lost misery to gain a new insight.
Right, because it's not just about losing weight to gain like confidence or a healthy body. It's losing this negativity.
Yes.
You know, and you know, losing this just bad things that you think about and everything. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you and your mom have been working together a lot, actually.
Oh, we do a ton together.
And, like, you want to talk about authoring? What else do you do?
Yes, she has wanted forever to write a children's book. That was her dream. So she wrote up bare bones basics of a story, and she asked me, she wasn't going to ask me to illustrate it because I have so much on my plate as it is, and she was like, maybe I could just go on and find some clip art. And I'm like, Mother, your daughter is an artist. Let me illustrate your book. So she wrote it and I illustrated it, and it's an adorable little children's book called Our Baby Is Here. Funny story, when we finally got the copy of the book and we posted a picture of me and Mom with the book, everybody starts messaging, Vi, are you pregnant? I'm like, no! It's a book title! My God! No! Zero! No! Absolutely not! No. Cancel, delete, no!
Right? Well, that's the funny thing, because, like, even though Vale and I didn't grow up together and we had, like, different backgrounds growing up, people ask us all the time if we're sisters.
On a soul level?
Yes, we are definitely sisters. Mm-hmm. And we think alike, and we're into the same things, and we both, like, the one thing that we did, like, grow up the same way is we almost mothered so many children.
Yeah.
That we don't really want our own.
Not at all. I have
like
two dogs.
Cool aunt power right here.
Oh, I have so many. I have lost count of how many nieces and nephews I have. I know there's almost 30 at this point. Something ridiculous, like 25 or 26 nieces and nephews. And then there's like almost.
Do some of them have kids already?
Oh, yeah.
I think you already have.
At least 10 great-nieces and nephews.
Yeah.
It's like, shouldn't I be 95 years old living in a dilapidated mansion on a hill if I'm a great-aunt?
Can we do that anyways?
Please? That'd be so cool. But yeah, I do not want human children. I have an 18-year-old chihuahua who is barking her head off in the background. And this 4-year-old pit lab, Sami, my little darling.
That you heard earlier.
Yes, she's the loud one I mentioned. But yeah, my dogs are the only children I want. Maybe someday a cow, maybe a goat, maybe a cat, a sugar glider. Just no humans. There's enough humans in this family. I don't want them.
I'm just going to warn you about a sugar glider. If you get one of those, you may not sleep very well at night.
Personal experience.
So, well, ladies and gentlemen, this has definitely been a very story. And unfortunately, there's a lot more to tell. But
we're just going to have to do this again.
Kind of
we're
out of time, yeah. So. Once again, thank you very much for
coming on
the show. I do appreciate it. I want to thank you and your family for everything they have done for the wonderful world that we live in.
Yes.
That is professional wrestling. It really, without the Wild Samoans, mm-hmm. The Samoan dynasty, there would not be this crazy world.
No.
I very much appreciate that.
And
thank you.
Personally, I'm going to put it out there. I mean, Mark and I say it to everybody, but personally, everything that your family has done for us, you know, I mean, like your friendship and sisterhood and your parents, like doing everything they can for us. I mean, we actually moved down to Florida before you did, but I feel like you guys take care of us more than we ever did for you. You know, it's nice to have a family like yours around that we can, you know, call if we need anything. And the same thing, I mean, anytime you guys need anything.
Thank you.
So.
Yeah, we've all been through a lot together. And that's the thing about wrestling. It could be wonderful, and it could be terrible, and it can be sad, and it could be joyous.
Right. They used to say it was a brotherhood, but because it's a brother and a sisterhood, we've been calling it's a hood. You know,
I like that.
It's a hood. I mean, Good things happen, bad things happen.
Just so you know, the sign in this hood is right here. Ladies and gentlemen, we thank you very much for joining us here. Wait a minute. I don't have the right voice to do this.
Is my turn?
Yes, go ahead.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you all so much for joining us here on Tales from the Highway, a wrestling podcast. Thank you, Ferrari, and thank you, James, for having me here on the show. It was my very first ever podcast interview. First time ever.
Throw it up.
That was just too sweet.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
But thank you so much for having me on the show. I'm so glad that you guys were my first podcast, because I know we had talked about this in the past.
Yeah.
And I've always wanted to do a podcast, but it's like, I don't know. Like, I don't know all these people, and I don't want them to ask anything weird or disrespectful or something that I don't feel comfortable with. And when you asked me, I said, oh my God,
it was,
yes.
It was like, the funny thing is, I'm like, okay, I'm going to message Vale. I'm like, why am I nervous about this? It's Vale. Like, I love her. And I was like, you know, James and I want to interview you. And it was like this resounding, like, yes, yes, I wanted to be on a podcast for so long. This is perfect. I was just thinking, like, I wanted to be on a podcast. I'm like, why was I so nervous about this? Like, it's so weird. So,
ladies and gentlemen, for the Queen of the Highway, Ferrari.
Thank you.
For the Princess of the Samoan Dynasty. Well, I'm James Pritzky. Thank you very much for joining us. And we will see you next week. Actually, you know what? Next weekend, I think we're going to take off. It's UFC weekend. I'm going to go out to watch the next one. So in 2 weeks, General Manager Brittany Diamond will be on the show. So that will be what we have here from Rock State Wrestling. We'll see you then. And by the way, this Saturday.
WXW Wrestling at the Mineola Recreation Center. You better be there.
See you.
Good night. A misunderstanding once, but now we look it in the eye. Ah! One. It's very large. This is the place of honor here in the little dining room. Now, if you turn this way, this one is a sea turtle painting that I did. Mom loves this. My mother is obsessed with sea turtles, as you will find out, because she bought several of my sea turtle paintings. I made her this one for her birthday 1 year, I think. Over here, we have... I do a lot of moon things and a lot of tree things. I love, 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 love the moon. These four are actually oil paintings, and it's one of the very few times I have dived into the world of oils. They're great to work with, they're fun to work with, but they're scary. I prefer acrylic. Acrylic is my love. So let's take a little peeky. Oh, if you'll look to your right here, the Shrunken Head.
Yes, it's
the Shrunken Head. And a copy of the book that I mentioned, Our Baby Is Here, written by Lynn Anoa'i, illustrated by Vale Anoa'i. Here it is, so cute. You'll have to order it online to read it, but it's a very cute book. Here's some Vale's buried treasures that have been made. Vertigo actually made this one. Remember I told you he had a pirate-themed one?
Oh, yes. I love it.
There's so many models, so many Vale's buried treasures in this house. And over here, I have my lighthouse wall. That's another thing my mom is obsessed with, is lighthouses. So I did a whole series of lighthouse paintings for her.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
And those have been up for a while, because I remember those.
Yeah, several years now. And then there's other paintings all over the place, but those are the ones that are kind of in the living room area.
Yes.
The common area of the house.
Yeah, it is. It's beautiful. It's like an art gallery in here. And
it feels like that, and I love that.
Right?
That's my dream. It's just to have my own gallery where every inch of wall space is my art.
All right. Well, thank you.
Oh, thank you. I'm so happy you're here.
Yes. We had a good time
today.
Let
me just hold on.
Hold
me. You were right there. Yes. Bring the boss out.
Yes, bring the boss. The real boss of the house that's been trying to tell us what to do.
So, this is my 18-year-old Chihuahua.
Who's that?
Madison. She is a pistol. She may be old, but she can still kick it.
I know, you probably can't see all that well, you poor
thing. Yeah, she's a little cloudy, but she still gets around. But yes, world, meet Madison. Sunny, okay. jealous.
Right? Aw. All right, well, that's the behind the scenes. I'm so glad we got all this video, because we haven't done that either. So, all right, guys, thanks.
I want to know, we actually are working on getting a studio set up, but obviously we do travel from time to time. You know, wires get tangled, so if you ever want to know what half of my job is, this is what it is. But you know what? It's all worth it for having wonderful guests on our show that we get to put to you every single weekend. So, you know, I hope you appreciate that we do that, because, you know, you got a lot of local talent that you don't really get to hear from because, you know, they don't really have that much TV time or radio time or air time. So this is what we do. We want to get the local talent out there. So as I said, next weekend we have Brittany Diamond on here. We have the Wild Samoan Family, a member of the... Well, come here.
Okay. Right? Yeah. And I'm like...
Hang on.
Here we go.
I gotta move the chair here. So, you know, I mean, come on. I mean, how can you not have the princess of the Wild Samoan Family right here on the show? You know, it's an amazing opportunity for you to know what's going on in independent wrestling scene. WXW, Rocksteady Wrestling, IPW. So there's so much going on right here in Florida that if you ever get a chance to come down here, not only to see Disney or SeaWorld or Universal Studios, it's a 25-minute drive north. And you can go meet the Wild Samoan Afa and the family. And it's a really great opportunity. And here you can listen to us talk about that so you know where you need to go. It's only just a little north of Claremont, right here in Mineola. Have a great time when you come out here, because I'll tell you right now, it's all about being part of the fan. That's what they do it for. I'm going to tell you right now, whether it's WXW, Rocksteady, Family Fun Wrestling, and you get the performers come out to actually visit you, talk to you, and they enjoy your company. That's what they're there for. But anything I can tell you about these two companies, they realize what the value is of the fans. Mm-hmm. So that is the most important thing. We love you fans, and we want you to come out and keep on coming out. So in other words, we'll see you on Saturday on the 12th for WXW. We'll see you November 2nd for RSW and the Gulfview Event Center. We look forward to you coming out. Thank you very much for this very special extra edition here of Tales from the Highway, a wrestling podcast.